pastor here, and I'd like for you to show your appreciation for Reverend Scot Ocke being here again today. Awesome. You know, it's another one of those weeks where there are a lot of things going on in the village, so I'm going to again suggest that just like that A-plus paper that you have on your refrigerator, you take home the program and put a magnet on that and keep it on the refrigerator as well. Of course, we still have our prayer group going strong on Wednesdays, but this Thursday we also have our Theology on Tap meeting at Sean's Irish Tavern at 6:30 on Thursday. So Wednesday we've got something going on. Thursday we have something going on. Someone needs to plan something for Friday, because right now there's nothing on the schedule for Friday. But hey, on Saturday we have a hayride and the bonfire. There's a sign-up sheet out in the welcome area for that. If you want to go to the hayride, sign up and mark that. If you want to go just for the bonfire, hey, just say that you're going to show up for the bonfire. Bring your own goodies. I believe we have some fixins for s'mores. We're going to get some hot dogs too, Susie. We're going to have some hot dogs. We'll grill out over the fire. So that'll be a grand old time. And then on Sunday, Rosie's got her Getting Married, What's the Rush seminar going on, correct? Do we still have flyers that are available for that?
Yes.
Okay. There are some flyers that are available.
It's not just about marriage. It's about all the alternatives and what God gives you to secure your relationship.
So it goes beyond marriage. Awesome. Thank you for mentioning that. Also out on the welcome table, or on our welcome table inside the worship space here, we have our special offering envelopes for neighbors in need. That is a special offering for the United Church of Christ. So if you have anything that you want to give in addition to your regular gift, please use that special offering envelope that is on the table, and you can drop that in the basket as well. And then next Saturday, just thinking ahead, I believe we also have a sign-up list for our Let's Feed Others event that we like to do periodically.
Friday.
And that's
Friday.
Did I say Saturday?
Yeah.
I meant Friday, because I know we bag up the lunches on Friday night to pass out on Saturday.
My bad,
as the kids would say. All right. I don't have anything else. Are there any other announcements that need to be made at this point? Yes. That's right here?
Yes.
2:30, Adams Family. Keep seeing all the set in the back. So if you would like to show up and see the Adams Family, a wonderful October event, that would be awesome. Right here at the Mommy Indoor. Anything else? All right, let's worship. Please stand.
We're going to start by singing Everlasting God.
Thank you.
praises with our God. Our midst this morning. Amen. maybe see them.
When we gather in community, we remember that God is with us. We know that we are imperfect people who make mistakes. We give thanks that God loves us anyway. In this community, we practice patience, compassion, and forgiveness. When we leave this gathering, we go out to share God's healing love with a broken world. We are Jesus' instruments of hope in our world. We are followers of Jesus, and we can change the world.
Our scripture today comes from the Gospel of Matthew. I'll be reading from the 4th chapter. From that time, Jesus began to proclaim, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven has come near." As he walked by the Sea of Galilee, he saw two brothers, Simon, who is called Peter, and Andrew, his brother, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And he said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." Immediately, they left their nets and followed him. As he went from there, he saw two other brothers, James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, in the boat with their father Zebedee, mending their nets. And he called them. Immediately they left the boat and their father and followed him. I'm going to bring up Reverend Scot Ocke once again to bring our message.
Good morning, all of you.
Good morning.
Great to be here and filling in for Pastor Sherry, and she is on a much-deserved spiritual renewal leave. So I want you to picture her today, because I think she's probably going to see this video that's being taken. It's about 11:15. She has her head propped up in her bed. Her husband is just entering into the bedroom, and he has a tray with an omelet and fresh strawberries and cinnamon rolls and hot coffee just for Sherry. And let me say, she deserves every bit of that. So why don't you say hi to her. Hi, Sherry.
Hi, Sherry.
We're glad you're enjoying your day today, and we love you very much. All right, we got that out of the way. Two simple words changed their lives. There were these four fisher type that are tending their nets along the Sea of Galilee. Now you and I know fishermen, that they are not the most reputable kinds of people. Back then especially, it was not the greatest profession that one could have. And you know how the story goes. The fish is like this big when you catch it. And when the story ends, it's like this big. And yet, Jesus sees them there in their boat. And he calls to them and he says to them two simple words. And these two men decide to follow Jesus. They leave everything that they have, their boat, their nets, their fish, everything. And they follow Jesus because of these two simple words. Now a little bit later, Jesus passes two other fisher types. Their names are James and John, the sons of Zebedee. Now these guys have reputations. They are called the sons of thunder, like father, like son. They were ballroom brawlers. They were tuned in to violence. I think they were just frustrated fishermen. But Jesus called, "Hey, follow me." And they leave their nets, they leave their boat, they leave their father, and sure enough, they follow Jesus. Now, when I read this story, I wonder how in the world this works. A counselor would say that you have to be really high on the ADD scale to simply give up whatever it is that you're doing and have a massive brain shift to do something radically different because of two simple words. And they would prescribe major prescription medicine for people like that. Or maybe you've had your kids come up to you. And they say, "Mom, Dad, I've got to have this. I've got to go there right now." And what do you say? "I can't drop everything and do that right now." And so who in the world drops everything and does something radically different because of two simple words? And why did these four fishermen do it? Well, maybe a better question for the morning is, would I do it? Would you do it? Would we do it? I mean, if Jesus came by this place and said two simple words, follow me, would we just drop everything and follow him? Now, I have a feeling that we would probably want to at least think about it. I know that I would. I confess that it took me 2 years after hearing my call to ministry to actually follow Jesus in ministry. And so we want to ponder the consequences. We think about our families. We would wonder about our reputation for making such a knee-jerk action. And we would say to ourselves, would I lose my house? I mean, would my relatives think that I had gone off the deep end? How could I live without my job or my income? Maybe more importantly for some of us, what about all of my stuff that I'd have to leave behind? Would we follow him? Would I follow him? Well, I am not sure about this. But I am very sure that it is not about me. I am sure that it is not about me. I'm going to tell you for a moment about this guy called Ptolemy. And Ptolemy was this Egyptian-born Roman scientist who lived back in the 2nd century AD. And Ptolemy concluded, after much research, that the earth was the center of the world. In other words, all of the other planets and the sun all rotated earth at its command. The sun rotated earth. And guess what happened? We became the center of the universe. Now maybe you know some people today that thinks everything revolves around them. And we call those kind of people egocentric. We call them full of themselves, and we call them narcissistic. Why don't you turn to your neighbor and say, I know who he's talking about. So if it's all about me, and it's my hang-ups and my questions and my fears and my stuff, then I'm never going to follow. But thank God for a 16th century astronomer by the name of Copernicus. And Copernicus discovered that Earth was not the center of the world. That the sun was the center of the universe, at least our universe. And Earth and the other eight planets revolve around the sun. I'd like to take you back maybe to elementary school or junior high. Do you remember how you remember the names of all the planets on Earth? Here's how I remembered it. Let's say it together. My very educated mother just served us 9 So, what do we get? Down here, Mercury, Venus, Earth, Mars, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune, Pluto. Those are all the planets in order, and all of them revolve around the sun. So guess what this means? It tells me that I'm not the center either. Because someone bigger than me created me. Someone smarter than me knows all about me. Someone more lovable than me loves even me. Now I confess that this is hard for me because you see, I still want to be the center. I still want it to be all about me. But Copernicus convinced the world it's not about us. That the sun does not rotate earth, but earth rotates sun. And so who's it all about? It's all about It's all about the sun. It's about the Son of God. The sun is the center, and so it is all about him. him. Now, I've been thinking about this. What was it that caused these four fisher dudes to follow him? I mean, if it's not about them, with all of their hang-ups and their reputations and our stuff and our questions and our consequences, then it must be about him. What is it about him that would make me want to leave whatever I'm doing and whatever I have to follow him? Was it his charisma? Now that was probably scary. Because maybe we would follow him to the extent that we would sell the farm. We would give up everything that we had ever earned. Maybe we'd even eventually drink the purple Kool-Aid. What is it that makes people want to follow him? Was it his passion for life? Or maybe his piercing brown eyes that could look straight through to my heart? Was it his drive to make the world right again? His ability to do what nobody else could do? Could it be his unconditional love? And could it be his ability to fulfill in me what I could never hope to fulfill in myself? In the video, In Remembrance, a scene that teaches us how hard it is to follow Jesus. Now, if you have ever been on a walk to Emmaus, you have seen the video In Remembrance on Thursday night. And the walk to Emmaus is a 72-hour spiritual retreat that is based on the scripture from Luke 24 as two disciples, Cleopas and an unknown disciple, are walking the road to Emmaus. Right after the crucifixion. They don't know that Jesus has come alive again. They don't understand the resurrection. And they are downtrodden. They think that life is over. And suddenly the risen Jesus comes up alongside them and walks this way. And it is a great spiritual experience. I can tell you it's one of the best that I've ever had in my life. I've made great friends. I've had great tools for ministry that have come through the walk to Emmaus. And if you've not been a part of that, I would recommend it to you. Happens two or three times over in Bryan, Ohio every year, and once up in Toledo each year. So it's a great spiritual experience, and I'd love to talk to some of you about it if you've not done it. But on the first night on the walk to Emmaus, you see this video, and the Apostle Philip, who is believed to probably have been the youngest of all the disciples, is contemplating and discussing his decision to follow Jesus with the love of his life, a beautiful young girl by the name of Rebecca. And Rebecca says to him, "I was afraid that you would go back, but I didn't think that it would be so soon." And Philip says, "I love everything about this place, and I miss it so much when I am gone, but I think Jesus, and I know I need him." And Rebecca replies, "Well, if your happiness is here, if our happiness is here, is that not more important than your traveling around Galilee following some itinerant rabbi?" Philip says, "I thought so. And there are some nights that have been so lonely that I would die out there. And every night I can see this house in my mind, and I think about you and all of the good times that we have and our love and our happiness." And Rebecca concludes, and she says, "I wake up in the morning and I say that the world is good. But then I think Philip is gone. The world is good. So maybe we can see that even these 12 that followed Jesus, it was so difficult. And yet in faith, they chose to follow him. but it is also about life change. Now Jesus says these two simple words, and their lives are changed. In fact, these two simple words have changed the lives of millions of people throughout the ages. Now Jesus' purpose of enticing us to follow him is so that he can make us his disciples. And a disciple is someone who is under the discipline of the master. And the purpose of the disciple is to become exactly like the master. And so if we are Jesus' disciples, our purpose is to become like him spiritually, emotionally, the way that we love, the way that we forget, in each and every way, we are to become like Jesus. Now, this is where a lot of us start to get really nervous, because a lot of us feel like those fishermen that were not too bright, they didn't have very good reputations, they were not very trustworthy, and this is why Jesus is all about changing discipleship is our job, but life change is Jesus' job. I want you to think with me what Jesus would do if he got a memo or an email way back then. So this memo or this email is addressed to Jesus of Nazareth. It is from the Jordan River Management Consulting. And they're responding to Jesus' request. And it says, "Dear sir, thank you for submitting the names of the 12 men you have picked for managerial positions in your new organization. All of them have now taken our battery of tests, and we have not only run the results through our computer, but also arranged for personal interviews for each of them and with our psychologist and vocational aptitude consultant. The profiles of all tests are included, and you will want to study each of them very carefully. As part of our service, we make some general comments for your guidance, much as an auditor would include with some general financial statements. This is given as a result of staff consultation and comes without any additional fee. It is the staff opinion that most of your nominees are lacking in background, education, and vocational aptitude for the type of enterprise that you are undertaking. They do not have the team concept, and so we would recommend that you continue your search for persons of experience and managerial ability and proven capability. For example, Simon Peter is emotionally unstable and given to fits of anger. Andrew has absolutely no qualities of leadership. Those two brothers, James and John, the sons of Zebedee, tend to undermine morale. We feel that it is our duty to tell you that Matthew has been blacklisted by the Greater Jerusalem Better Business Bureau. And James, the son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus, definitely have radical leanings, and they are both registered a high score on the manic depressive scale. One of your candidates, however, shows great potential. He is a man of ability and resourcefulness. He meets people well, has a keen business mind, and has contacts in high places. He is highly motivated, ambitious, and responsible, and therefore, we recommend Judas Iscariot to be your controller and right-hand man. All of the other profiles are self-explanatory, and we wish you every success in your new venture. Sincerely, the Jordan Management Consulting Company." Now, we hear that, and what do? We say, that's me. That's us that they're talking about. Jesus would be a fool to use me. But you see, this is precisely the point. Because you and I are just like those disciples. Those disciples 2,000 years ago represent you and me today. They are the same as us. And they followed him, and he changed their lives for the better, and he turned them into great preachers, writers, leaders, miracle workers that changed the lives of hundreds and thousands. thousands of people. And so don't you even dare to begin to think that because you don't exhibit the greatest strengths or that you don't have the greatest examples of godly living in your life that Jesus can't or won't use you. Because you are exactly the kind of folk that Jesus is looking for. I want to invite you to read this with me on the screen. If you would, let's read it out loud. Did you think that because he's such a nice God, he'd let you off the hook? Better think this one through from the beginning. God is kind, but he is not soft. In kindness, he takes us firmly by the hand and leads us into a radical life change. Follow me. Follow me, and I will make you fishers of men. And these men change their lives, their lifestyles, their occupations, and even their names, from Simon to Peter, from Saul to Paul, and there were many others, Peter, Andrew, James, and John, leaving their nets, their father, their little towns where they grew up, and following Jesus were all signs and symbols of great life. See, the purpose of the Bible, and the purpose of this Bible story in particular, is to show us what is and can happen to the likes of us. And so we hear the call of Jesus, and something urges us to follow him. And maybe it's just a disillusionment that we have with the rest of the world, or we're in this unfulfilling job setting, or we have this great need for love, or we just have this discontented life. And somehow, some way, we hear these two simple words and we reach out in faith and we take a risk. We begin to follow. I have done some fishing up near Toronto, Canada, at a place called Rice Lake. Most recently with a couple of friends named Sam and Dave. And all of us are Christ followers, and it's great to be together, to eat together, and pray together, and fish together. And so we support one another while we're there. And if one of us catches a big fish, then the others applaud. And if none of us catch fish, then we kind of console one another. But it's always a great time. But I remember the time before that, going to Rice Lake with another friend. I'm going to call him Dan, even though that is not his real name. And Dan was one of those guys who never had any use for the church. Now, his wife was there every Sunday. His son and his daughter were there every Sunday, but Dan never showed his face in the church. And what I heard was that he believed that the only thing that the church wanted from him was his money. But his wife and his family kept encouraging him, and so after a long time, he decided to come to church with them. Now, lo and behold, he shows up the first week in November. Now, that's the week that many churches start their stewardship campaign about how much you're going to give to the church so that it can do its business for the following year. Bad time to show up if you're somebody like him. And so after the service is over, I hear Dan mumbling under his breath, "I told you all they wanted is my money." But for some reason, Dan kept showing up. He was there more than he wasn't there. He continued to come until he would be called very regular and was in one of our membership classes and became a member of that church. He went to Sunday school. He completed the 40 or whatever it is weeks of disciple Bible study. And then he decides that he wants to teach disciple Bible study. He also went on a walk to Emmaus. And so despite all of Dan's setbacks and obstacles, Dan is on his way to making Christ the center of his life. Now most of us, myself included, change happens pretty gradually for us. I told you that I got a call to ministry probably 2 years before Heather made that commitment. commitment to Jesus. But if you look at this graph that is on the screen behind me, then you can see kind of how, and for a number of us, our faith life works. So we begin by exploring Christ. And we start to wonder if what is said about Jesus is really true, or if it's just a bunch of fairy tales. And so we begin to test this with people that we know who already seem to have a relationship with Jesus. And then something happens. Now, for those disciples, it was two simple words, follow me. And it might be that for you. It might have been that for somebody else. But it might be something like we have a dream. Or we're suddenly diagnosed with a bad illness. We discover a need that no human being can possibly fulfill. Or we go to a concert. We hear someone speak. Hearts are moved by the music and the words of Jesus come to us. We begin to feel his presence. And there's all kind of catalysts like that make that happen. And eventually we throw it all down and we begin to follow. This is only the beginning. We then begin to grow in our relationship with Christ. And our spiritual life is enhanced and embodied. We are part of a lifelong pursuit, and we begin to grow closer to him. And we keep growing to become more like the Master, this whole discipleship process, until Jesus is the very center of our heart and souls. And so we move from the Simon that is in us to the Peter that we can truly be. We can move from the Saul that is in us to the Paul that God calls us to be. I can move from the Scot who is in me to the Scot that God has created and called me to be. And you can put your own name in there. So it's all about how our lives are changed by following Jesus Christ. And then finally, I need to say to you that it is about unity. Anybody here today desire unity? I mean, think about it. I mean, most people say, get the arguing and the politicking and the fighting and the division away and let us just come together in unity. And so what happens? Congressmen raise their heads. And then all the popular people, the movie stars or the rock stars or coaches or entrepreneurs or business gurus and even preachers say, hey, follow me and I will unite us. We will bring the company, the church, the team, the nation, the economy, the whole world together. And you know what I say to that? Something I can't say in this room. Because I know it is never going to work. It never happens. So how does it happen? He says, follow me. And when we do, he brings us into unity with himself. And then he sends us out in mission to be in unity with others. Go into all the world and make disciples in all nations. Karl Barth was this Swiss theologian and who publicly stood against Adolf. And Karl Barth said this, the Word became flesh, and then through theologians, it became words again. The Word became flesh, and through theologians, it became words again. Now, what does he mean by that? I think that he meant that the world changes not by our words, but by our following. The actions that accompany that following. And he wanted Christ followers to act on their beliefs and not just talk about them. Now the Bible says this, and I want you to read this with me again. And this is the Apostle Paul that is speaking, because he knew he could not do it on his own. So here's what he says. Read it with me. I appeal to you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that all of you agree and that there be no dissension among you, but that you be united in the same mind and the same judgment. These are words that bring us together. And Paul knew that he couldn't do it. So what did he do? He said, I appeal to you, brethren, brothers and sisters, by the name of our own Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus is the only way to unite. I want you to think lastly about all the places that Jesus chooses to minister. It says this, that what was spoken by the prophet Isaiah might be fulfilled. The land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, toward the sea, across the Jordan, Galilee of the Gentiles. The people who sat in darkness have seen a great light, and those who sat in the region and the shadow of death, on them light has dawned. Now these places are remote places. They are out there places. They are out there people. And yet Jesus chooses to go to them to make these people and these places that are way out there come together. Now, Jesus could have easily stayed and spent most of his ministry around Jerusalem, all those long-time and educated Jews. But he chose to go out into the country, to those other nations of people that were in the dark about God. Because Jesus wants to bring people, and he wants to bring nations together, and he wanted to bring unity that no other person. And no one else has ever brought it since that time. And he still wants to do that in us today. Now, I certainly don't have all the answers about this. But I am convinced without doubt that two simple words, the beginning of life change and about world unity. Jesus has already changed millions of lives. And I know without question that he is calling each and every one of us in this room. Now the question becomes, where is he going to take us? Who are we going to be? What kind of ministry are we going to be in? Will we be brought into unity with other people and with Christ because we are his disciples and follow? How's the world going to change for people that we come into contact? You know, honestly, I have to say, I don't know. I don't know all of those specifics. I do know that Jesus is calling us. I know that he is still changing lives, that Jesus is powerful, and he loves us all unconditionally. And the question is the same one that Karl Barth asked a long, long time ago. Will we stop? Or will we do something that changes our lives? The lives of hundreds, maybe thousands. Lord, I thank you for your presence among us today. For your challenge that no matter where we are in life, no matter what we have done, no matter what we have left undone, no matter our political preferences, or whatever it is that identifies ourselves and others, you still love us, and you are still calling us. And I pray, Lord, that your Spirit would give every one of us courage right now to hear those words and do exactly what those fishermen did, Peter and Andrew, James and John, countless thousands of millions since that time. We would simply follow you to the greatest life change that we could ever have. a little bit. So hear these words, the Lord be with you, and also with you. Let us give our thanks and praise to our Lord. God, it is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty Father, Creator of heaven and earth. Holy, holy, holy Lord, your God of power and might. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name. So, Lord, we give you thanks for your goodness, for your love, which you have made known to us in creation, the calling of Israel, the calling of our very selves to your Son. You are the one who has come, the Word become flesh. Help us, Lord, not to just allow that to become words again. Help us to act out. So, Lord, for all that you have done, you have called us worthy to be your disciples. So we stand before you today, acknowledging who you are, hearing your call upon our lives, desiring to move forward. And so on the night before Jesus died, as he met with those disciples in that upper room, he took bread, blessed it, he broke it, gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body, which is broken for you." And after the supper, he took the cup, he lifted it high, and he blessed it. "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for many, for forgiveness of your sins, as long as you will drink of this." Let's pray the Lord's Prayer. Hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power. Take a piece of the broken bread, dip it in the cup, take and eat in celebration of what Jesus has done for you. And you're welcome to return to your seat in the opposite way. So let us come and let us celebrate Christ's birthday.
couple of prayer requests, which I will mention in just a moment, but let's go to the Lord in prayer, shall we? Lord, all over the world, there are people in need, people that are without hope. From Oregon to New Jersey, from New Jersey to the tip of Africa, from the tip of Africa to Israel, Russia, all of these places, there are people that are deeply hurting. There are people without hope. Lord, they are known, every one of them, by you. And we ask that by your Spirit that you would touch them. They would know that you are in charge of this world, even if it seems so impossible to you. Lord, I pray that you would use us locally to reach out to those same folks that aren't so far away, but deal with all of the same things. That we could be Christ. They would know that they are in your presence somehow because of us. And then because of us, that they might want to follow you. TNC are asking us to pray for two friends in a family that is struggling with addiction. And one is to bring a daughter back living on the streets, needs to know that she is deeply loved. So Lord, we pray that that would happen. Someone in California would hear your call. Reach out to her. See her. We also pray with Pat and Cindy for a gentleman named Paul, who lives in Colorado Rockies. He's facing serious health problems. So we lift Paul to you and ask that through the beauty of nature, you would reveal yourself to him again. Or even as he looks into the night sky, that he would know that the heavens are declaring the glory of God. He would know that he is bless these. Bless others who remain silently in need. For they are all your children. We love them so very much. Hear our prayers in the name of Jesus Christ. And everybody said, amen. I believe that it is time for our offering, as God has given generously to you, that you would also give generously back to our Lord in the work of this church, the work of this kingdom, continue in a great thank you. Yeah, great. And as you prepare to leave from this place, may the sun always shine upon your face. May the road before you be easy, the wind be behind your back. Maybe most important, may you keep your ears tuned to the voice of Jesus, who says to you,